Last night, I attended a reading meeting at a club which will remain nameless. The meeting was billed as being a step meeting. It turned out that what they did was to read the second step in the 12 o'clock. And then there was some kind of a half-hearted discussion about it afterwards. I got thinking, what is it that, what's missing here? Well, just about everything. Because although the 12 and 12 has some very nice essays in it, it nowhere tells us what to do. There are no instructions for working the steps. And I got thinking that since this workshop, we've been spending a lot of time on Bill's story. And you remember that we saw Bill working his first step. Remember how over and over again he came to realize that he was whipped, that if there was a devil, the devil really had him, that he had reached an absolute end, that he could go no further. And when his friend Eddie came and faced Bill with the prospect of recovery, Bill had to recognize at that point that he was totally whipped. So we watched that first step being worked in Bill's story, which is really important because it lays the groundwork for what we later see in the third chapter, where the big book tells us that we learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we were alcoholic, and this is the first step in recovery. And then, to turn back one page, on page 12, here we find Bill working his second step. And we also see, as we read this part of Bill's story, exactly what Abby did to help Bill to accept the fact that God is, and God is everything, and to come to believe that God could restore him to sanity. And we see what it took. First of all, Bill had to come to the understanding, didn't he, that he could choose his own conception of God. He wasn't stuck with any preconceived notion or anything that was going to be forced on him by the Oxford group or any other group. He could choose his own conception. And that opened the door for him. And then, on page 12, we also see that Abby then instructed him that it was only necessary that he be willing to believe, that nothing more was required of him to make a beginning. And that, of course, that idea is repeated four times in chapter 4, we agnostics. So there's no question that these are keys to the second step. Also, we see in Bill's story, remember that Bill had great doubts about whether God would have anything to do with him personally. Although he could recognize that there was probably some great power out there, he was not willing to accept that this great power could have any interest in him as a single human being. And it turned out that this all came together for him. We read that as soon as he came to believe that there was this power and this power could restore him to sanity, something happened to him. He doesn't elaborate on it. What he says is that thus was I convinced that God is concerned with us humans when we want him enough. So you can see all of the roots of the second step are right here in Bill's story. And that's important because for a number of reasons. Nowhere in chapter 4 or in third chapter is the second step elaborated in terms of how we get there. How do we come to this belief? And of course, the truth is that this belief is ultimately a gift, come to us as a gift. But there are certain things that we can do. Among others, for example, Bill said that he learned he had to pray just as if there were a God. And then when the miracles started coming, and he could no longer deny that they came from a power greater than himself, that's when faith came. And he said that faith was the greatest gift of all. Now remember that the 12th step is considered to be elucidated and expanded upon in chapter 7, working with others. Unfortunately, there's much left out of chapter 7, which does not directly address the 12th step at all. For example, it does not address the question of a spiritual awakening. Now that's not unusual, not unusual at all. Once we understand the big book and understand how it was written, and understand that Bill never used that term. In the big book, everywhere else, the term is spiritual experience. And that's explained over and over again. When he wrote the 12th step, he used that term again, having had a spiritual experience as a result of working these steps. And that was changed before the big book went to press. But nobody thought to examine what does that mean? What is a spiritual awakening? Well, in the context of the big book, it has the same connotation as spiritual experience, because Bill did not mean, when he wrote spiritual experience, he did not mean a bright light, burning bush, epiphany. He was talking about a whole series of experiencings of God, and all of which come about as a result of us taking one leap of faith after another as we work the steps. Nor does the seventh chapter give us a lot of background on why we have to do this. Why is it necessary for us to carry this message? It does tell us on the first page of the seventh chapter that nothing will so much ensure against next drink as intensely work with other alcoholics, and that this works when other methods fail. And it tells us that we will thoroughly enjoy doing this, we'll have a host of friends, and so on. But it never really gets down to the question of survival. Where do we find that? We find that in Bill's story. And we find it on pages 14 and 15, where when Bill was in the hospital for the last time, he was inspired to understand that it was going to be necessary for him to carry the message he'd been given while he was in the hospital to other alcoholics. And remember at the bottom of page 14, when he talked to his friend Ebbie about this, Ebbie related this requirement to the spiritual maxim that faith without works is dead. And what he was saying is, Bill, you can have all the faith in the world, and you obviously have had, by that time when Bill had had his epiphany, his great spiritual experience, but Ebbie said, that's not going to be of any particular value to you unless you put it to work. In other words, the message there is pretty clear that we must give away what we've been given, that it is not enough to have faith, but that we must practice faith, which means actively trusting God. And so as Bill spoke with his friend Abby, he came to understand something which is basic to why we're here, what we're doing here. What's this sponsorship stuff all about? At the bottom of page 14. And this stuff is so basic that it bears repeating so that we always remember where it is in the book and we can allude to it. We need to be able to show our sponsees just how critically important this is. For example, if they want to know, you know, So Marilyn, how come you were taking all this time with me? And then you frankly, you can really honestly say, well, because it's something I must do. I must do. And again, I heard at this lousy meeting last night something about there are no busts in AA. Well, you see, the leader who spoke those immortal words was mistaking the language found in the traditions with the rest of the program. Because in the tradition, that statement is made, there are no musts in AA. That means in terms of the traditions, in terms of behavior, everything in the traditions is stated as we ought to or we should, never that we must. Because none of the traditions have the force of law. They are things which we ought to do, and we should do, but there's no AA police force or AA judicial system to enforce them. That's why it says there are no musts in AA. There are hundreds of categorical imperatives in the Big Book. Not all of them are labeled as must in that many words. But wherever we find that these are things that we have to do or that we must do, it means or else. It means or else means no recovery. When Bill finally got it through his head what was going on here, he realized and he writes this down for us, something which is of critical importance to all of us. The bottom of page 14. Faith without works is dead, he said. And how appallingly true for the alcoholic. How much more true do you have to get than appallingly true? For if an alcoholic failed to perfect and enlarge his spiritual life through work and self-sacrifice for others, he could not survive the certain trials and low spots ahead. If he did not work, he would surely drink again, and if he drank, he would surely die. Then faith would be dead. Indeed, with us it is just like that. Now what in the world don't we understand about that language? And yet so many people seem to be of the opinion that once having done 90 and 90 and maybe gone to a bunch of meetings and signed up to be the coffee maker, that there's nothing more they have to do. Because they're told so many times, just don't drink and go to meetings. Meeting makers make it, and on and on and on and on. The truth is in the Big Book, and it's so seldom heard these days around the room. But you and I, if we're going to be effective sponsors, if we're going to honor the opportunity that God gives us to bring this message to others, to see them recover, we need to know what we're doing. And we need to bring the message that the Big Book gives us to bring. It's a message of recovery, which, by the way, never fails. Never fails for those who actually do it. Remember what we read every time we hear the promises read? Sometimes quickly, sometimes slowly. Will always materialize if we work with it. That the program, the 12 steps, never fails. Never fail if we go about it with one half the deal we used to go about getting our next round. All those things are true. And it's for us to understand that what we're dealing with here is an enormous power which is available to anybody, and it's our job to show our sponsees how to tap into that power. And they do that by working their steps. Now then, we've come to the part of Bill's story where Bill has left the hospital. He has become convinced that he's going to have to take what he's been given and take it out and see if he can help other alcoholics to give them what he was given. Now you can imagine the scene when he went home to his wife Lois, and he told her, Lois, I'm going to have to take this wonderful recovery method that I've been taught, and I'm going to have to take it out, and I'm going to have to try to help other people with it. And I don't know that he did this, but I can just imagine saying, Lois, will you support me in this? Now you can imagine what would have happened if she'd, oh no, Buster, no way, are you kidding? I've been putting up with your nonsense for 25 years. You're sober now, you're going to stay sober, but you are not leaving this house without permission. And there's no such thing as you going out there and mixing it up with a whole bunch of drunken bums. Probably want to bring them home and feed them. No way. Now you can start out by carrying out the garbage. But that isn't what she said. What she said was, yes, Phil, I will support you. I will help you. And she did. For the rest of Bill's life, she was right there with him. And after he died, she kept the work going. Thank God for that. Can you imagine where we would be if the answer had been, don't you dare? You're sober, you just keep on keeping on here, guy, because you're not going to have anything more to do with that bunch of drunken bum you call friends. Just another one of those very slender threads upon which the beginnings of this fellowship depended. Had they not materialized exactly as they did, we wouldn't be here. And I can name you about 10 or 12 other instances which were just as critical to the early days of this fellowship. It had to happen exactly as they did, or we wouldn't be here. Many, many of us, including myself, been dead long ago. So here we find that Bill is starting out on this odyssey, which, by the way, lasted 6 months, where he was making valiant attempts to help other alcoholics, to carry this message. He later reported in one of his writings that his techniques left a lot to be desired, like walking into a bar and seeing some guy with his head down, tapping him on the shoulder, saying, son, looks to me like you're an alcoholic, and I'm going to get you sober. How do you like that? And I can imagine the guy said, well, sir, well, that's all right. You know, maybe you had to call me a chap first. If the guy gave him any indication he was willing to get sober, Bill would immediately have to tell him he got to start praying. He just imagined this guy sitting there on the bar stool and he's socking down his drinks. And Bill Wilson walked in, this big, tall, gangly guy, said, okay, you're drunk, on your knees, start praying. That didn't work very well. In fact, it didn't work well at all. So Bill went 6 months trying desperately to get anybody to follow him, and nobody would. Now, here's another one of those slender threads. Bill could very easily at that point have given up. He was frustrated, no doubt about it. See, he knew by then that this stuff worked, that it was working well for him. And rather than give up, he went to talk to his friend Silkworth, Dr. Silkworth. And Dr. Silkworth knew what Bill was doing, and he knew what he was doing was wrong. But you see, Silkworth had watched him around his hospital with a couple of the patients there that were considered hopeless. And he could see that Bill was not using the tools that he had to use in order to carry this message. And so he told him. He told him how the cow ate the cabbage. He said, look here, before you do anything else, you have to get this person to believe you, to listen to you. Got to have some idea you know what you're talking about. You got to tell them your story. Tell them how you drank, how alcohol affected you. Tell them about the bewilderment, terror, despair, frustration. Tell them how you tried to stop and couldn't. Tell them how you came close to dying, suicide. Then, maybe, you'll identify enough with you, you'd be willing to listen to you, figuring maybe you know what you're talking about. And then he said, Bill, I found this out with you. He said, you remember the last time you were in my hospital? Before you left, I let you know and your wife know that you were incurable, that you were hopeless as far as I was concerned. I couldn't do anything for you. If you didn't stop drinking, you'd be dead in a year. So you got to hit him with this sledgehammer, Bill. You got to know what's facing them. You have to smash them down with this. Make sure they understand that this is a disease that they have, and it's incurable, it's going to kill them. That they have to stop drinking if they're to live. And if they're still interested, Bill, he said, Dad, you tell them how you recover. Well, if you go to chapter 7, the first 8 pages of chapter 7, you'll find that even today, what Dr. Silkworth told Bill clear back then is exactly the way chapter 7 is laid out. This is the way we work with a newcomer. And this gave Bill new hope. So we can see that slender thread having been reinforced a little bit there by Silkworth. And then Bill went to Akron, Ohio on business, and he fell on his sword. It was terrible. He just, everything he went there to do fell apart. And you see him standing in the hotel, and he's getting ready to go in the bar and drink. And right in front of him is this message board with the names of the pastors, the names of churches, the phone numbers, right square in front of him. The thought came to him, if I could find somebody to help, I won't drink. He picked a phone number at random. He called the number. The pastor was there. He asked, told the pastor what he needed. The pastor put him in touch with Henrietta Seaver. This pastor he called just happened to know Henrietta. So Bill called Henrietta. She just happened to know Dr. Bob. And Dr. Bob just happened to be in, and he wasn't too drunk. And Bill went to him, and then Bill did what Dr. Silkworth had told him to do. And Dr. Bob later said he was the first person who ever talked to me to know what he was talking about. He said, I hadn't listened to him. Just think, each of those slender threads had to be in place, or we wouldn't be here. It's an amazing story. So here in Bill's own words, on page 15, first full paragraph. My wife and I abandoned ourselves with enthusiasm to the idea of helping other alcoholics to a solution of their problems. It was fortunate, for my old business associates remained skeptical for a year and a half, during which I found little work. I was not too well at the time and was plagued by waves of self-pity and resentment. This sometimes nearly drove me back to drink, but I soon found that when all other measures failed, work with another alcoholic would save the day. That's practically identical language with the first sentence of the 7th chapter, isn't it? See how, as we read Bill's story, we're looking at what we're going to find in the rest of the book. Over and over again, these same ideas are presented to us in maybe a little different format, a little different language. But it's always the same message. Why are we here? Why are you and I here? I soon found that when all other measures failed, work with other alcoholics will save the day. Many times I've gone to my old hospital in despair. On talking to a man there, I would be amazingly lifted up and set on my feet. It is a design for living that works in rough going. That's another phrase that we need to remember, a design for living, which works in rough going. Over and over again, we hear the same thing. For example, one of the toughest things we and our sponsees have to face is the fact that we have an extraordinarily powerful sex instinct, something which causes tremendous harm, tremendous upset around the AA. Perhaps nothing is more deadly to recovery than some of these relationships, which are dependency relationships, which are centered not around love and caring and mutuality, but around sex. And there's a big book that says there's nothing wrong with sex. In fact, it's good. It's God-given. But we can't use it lightly or selfishly, and that's exactly what we find. We find people becoming distracted by their relationships and forgetting that they have to take care of themselves, that they have a purpose in life now, other than self-indulgence. And so, what the big book tells us then is if sex is very troublesome, what do? We throw ourselves harder into helping others. Because this will quiet the imperious urge. When to give in would mean heartache. Remember? So this whole idea repeats itself throughout the book. What Bill tells here, you're going to find over and over again. Many times I've gone to my old hospital in despair. On talking to a man there, I would be amazingly lifted up and set on my feet. And Dr. Silkworth was a participant to some degree in all of this. But this was Towns Hospital, Bill's talking about, where he was a patient three different times. When he got sober, finally he was in that hospital. Dr. Silkworth wasn't letting Bill work with people that he still had hope for. He was sicking them on to people that he had sucked off in the alcohol over there, people that were hopeless cases that they knew they could not help. Can you imagine what was going on? Because later it was not just Bill, it was all the guys from the New York group were coming in there. Can you imagine, here's a guy sitting lying in this bed, maybe strapped down. They know they can't help him. They've done all their scientific stuff on him. Nothing worked. And here these two guys would walk in, or Bill would walk in. The first day, maybe they would just talk to this fellow. Now you see them talking, and they're telling their story. We see these guys start to nod, like, yeah, that sounds like me too. And then maybe the next day or the following day, you're sober and you're walking past this ward and you see these guys praying again. And a couple days later, this hopeless, helpless case gets up and walks out of your hospital. And a month later, guess what? He's back working with the next guy in the next bed. Sober saw us. He knew. He had to know over a period of time exactly what he was looking at. That's why, in Dr. Silkworth's opinion, remember what the last word of Dr. Silkworth's opinion is? Pray. Says you might come to scoff, but hopefully you'll stay to pray. He saw it. Going on page 15, middle page, second full paragraph. We commenced to make many fast friends. And a fellowship has grown up among us, of which it is a wonderful thing to feel a part. The joy of living we really have, even under pressure and difficulty. I've seen hundreds of families set their feet in the path that really goes somewhere. Have seen the most impossible domestic situations righted, feuds and bitterness of all sorts wiped out. I've seen men come out of silence and resume a vital place in the lives of their families and communities. Business and professional men have regained their standing. There is scarcely any form of trouble and misery which has not been overcome upon us. In one Western city and its environs, there are 1,000 of us in our families. We meet frequently so that newcomers can find the fellowship that they seek. At these informal gatherings, men may often see from 50 to 200 persons. We are growing in numbers and power. Now, you may well wonder, what's the difference between 100 men and women, as reported in the Board of Diversification, and these thousands that, or thousands that they're talking about, meetings of 200. I'll tell you what happened. By the time the big book was getting ready to be printed, not the original draft, but the formal printed, Bill's alluding to the Cleveland group. Here's what happened with that. There were a series of 8 articles published in the Cleveland Plain Dealer, the newspaper, a major newspaper in town. One after another, for 8 days, they ran articles. And in that time, hundreds, literally hundreds of people sought out AA in Cleveland. It's an interesting story among other reasons, because the original group felt that these newcomers who were seeking help could only be helped by the old-timers. But they found out that wasn't so. What would happen was they'd go out and they'd find somebody, he would start working with them. And then there would come another call, this guy may have been sober 2 or 3 days, and they didn't have anybody else to go talk to the newcomer, so they sent the new guy out. And lo and behold, these new guys were bringing them in too. So it kind of took the wind out of the sails of all the old-timers, that they figured they had an exclusive patent, you see, on their ability to be helpful. And these new guys were bringing them in too, and that's the way they expanded. They had over 300 members within the first couple of weeks. That was from 15 to 300. Now, I have personal experience with this kind of thing, because when I was in the country of Colombia, I was living in Bogota, and I ran into Father Jerome, who was a missionary father. He's a Jesuit. He's a member. And we had a couple of meetings together in Bogota, and then I met him again in Medellin. We got talking, and Jerry said, you know, Jim, there are some places here in Colombia the deaths of the need of AA, there is no AA. He said, I've got permission from the bishop to do some missionary work in the alcoholism field. He said, would you help me? And I said, sure, Gary, what do you want to do? He said, well, I'd just like to have you go with me. I said, fine, where do we want to start? And he said, well, there's a little city down on the headwaters of the Amazon called Leticia. And it's a transfer point for the cocaine paste coming in from Bolivia and Ecuador. And it's also at the headwaters of the Amazon, so there's a lot of traffic that comes all the way up the river there. But so they're isolated there because there's no way to get in from here except to fly in. It's mountains and jungles all the way. So I said, there's a lot, they need a lot of help down there from us, and will you help me down? I said, sure. So the only way that we could get down there was in an old DC-3 that made the trip down there once a day. So we got on this airplane and we flew down And you have to see this little city to really understand what it's like. It's surrounded on all sides, except one, by jungle. And the one side where there's no jungle is the river, which at that point is not real big, but it's still 200-300 yards wide, full of what they call down there cocodrilos, crocodiles, and there's still jaguars running around out there in the jungle, and there's all kinds of weird stuff going on. The people, so many of the people in that town are directly involved in the transportation, illegal transportation of substance. And others, of course, are just normal townspeople. They just have to be where they live. At night, there are two small hotels in this town. And one of them had a kind of a conference room. What you couldn't really call it a ballroom or anything like that, but it was a fairly good sized room on the first floor. So we were staying at this hotel, and it's amazing there at night because you can hear the crocodiles down in the river roaring, and you hear the jaguars out in the jungle roaring, and there's all kinds of noise going on. And then every once in a while it's punctuated with a gunshot or two. And as you walk down the streets, these guys are walking around with their sidearms, just like you're out in the old west, you know. Seemed like everybody, we saw every guy we saw was armed. So anyway, we went to the hotel management. We arranged to rent this room. So we took out an ad in the paper that said, if you have a drinking problem, come to a free seminar on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock at this hotel. And Jerry and I figured, yeah, maybe four or five people show up. By the time, we never really got an accurate count on it, but I know it was over 300 people showed up. And they were standing outside, we kind of circulated around. I'm not fluent in Spanish, but first Jerry is, so he did all the talking. Out of this 300 or so people who showed up for that free seminar, 30 of them formed the first group in Latisha. And I hear from Jerry about once every 2 or 3 months. He's still down there. And they're still going. We've got 3 groups in town now. They're signed up in New York, and they're going great. We went from there to, we ended up going to 5 other small towns, or, you know, little cities, and doing the same thing. And the same pattern repeated itself. We don't know what would have happened had we said come to an AA meeting, but we said come to a free seminar. A lot of people showed up, and all those little towns and cities now have active AA going. So I know just how deep the need is, and I know from firsthand experience that once the door is open, the hope of recovery just runs right through a community. That's what happened in Cleveland. And that's why Bill was able to report a little later that they had as many as 200 people showing up for meetings, because that's actually what happened in Cleveland. They didn't have any hand in writing the big book, however. You remember that the big books, they started writing the big book in 1937, 1938. 1939, but it was kind of a lot of it was just word of mouth for a long time. Some parts of Bill's manuscript were scattered around, people commented on it. The basic hard work to really put it together didn't occur until the end of 39, beginning of 1940. So I'm going through all this so you'd be able to explain to your sponsees why the apparent a discrepancy here. Okay. Page 16, first full paragraph. An alcoholic in his cups. Everybody know what that means? Being in your cups? If you imagine some kind of a gigantic everybody had to crawl into. No. In your cups means drinking. As if the liquor were in a cup, in your cups means I'm drinking. An alcoholic in his cups. And it always implies heavy drinking. That term is never used for milk or water or Coca-Cola. In your cups means heavily drinking alcoholic spirits. Is an unlovely creature. Our struggles with them are variously strenuous, comic, and tragic. One poor chap committed suicide in my home. He would not or could not see our way of life. Now, that's very common. And as sponsors, of course, you're going to be subjected to that from time to time. Remember what the big book tells us? We hear it almost every meeting when we read how it works. That rarely ever seen a person fail was thoroughly followed our path. Those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. And then it also says usually those who are unable or incapable, constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. There are going to be many that you will find as you go through your sponsorship career who are unwilling to accept our way of life, who are unwilling to make a complete surrender. Usually because they are unwilling and unable to be honest with themselves. This is not a program for sissies. It takes a significant amount of courage to be willing to face ourselves. And you're not always going to find that your newcomers are going to fall into that category. Don't be discouraged. Quite often, when they are more badly beaten up, that'll change. And all we can pray for is that they survive. Then, this is I was telling Jane before me, this is paragraph I was looking for. I think I know the big book pretty well, but for some reason I had in mind that this paragraph was to be found back in the 8th or 9th chapters. But here it is. There is, however, a vast amount of fun about it all. I suppose some will be shocked at our seeming worldliness and levity. But just underneath, there is deadly earnestness. And here's this is the truth that runs through our entire program. Faith has to work 24 hours a day in and through us, or we perish. Remember what Bill learned as he went to Evie and told Evie about what had happened, that he'd had this epiphany, this bright light burning bush experience, that he thought he was going to need to carry this message to others. And Evie said, yes, Bill, faith without works is dead. And here we find it again. Faith has to work 24 hours a day in and through us, or we perish. Now that idea, of course, is carried forward in other parts of the big book, but most strongly on page 85. Let's take a look there. In the first full paragraph, about a third of the way down the page, it is easy to let up on the spiritual program of action and rest on our laurels. We are headed for trouble if we do. For alcohol is a subtle foe. We are not cured of alcoholism. Here it goes. What we really have is a daily reprieve. There's the 24 hours we're talking about. Contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition. And then again, every day, every 24 hours, is a day when we must carry a vision of God's will for us into all our activities. And earlier we learned that the spiritual life is not a theory, we have to live. So again, as we look at Bill's story, we find over and over again that we are given a foretaste of what is to come. The rest of the book revolves around everything that Bill reported to us here about himself and the things he had learned. Faith has to work 24 hours a day in and through us, or we perish. We need to impress upon our sponsees, don't we, that there are no vacations from AA. We don't build up any kind of spiritual bank account. This is a daily program of daily effort, which means that each day we're going to be living that day in the spirit of the 12-step, practice these principles in all of our affairs, and carry this message to other alcoholics. And when we can finally get our sponsees to see that this is not typical of other ways that they've learned to live their lives, the habits they've built up over the years, that there's something quite different here. When I asked my sponsors, what does one day at a time mean? They said, it means today I went to a meeting. Today I prayed. Today I meditated. Today I took inventory. And today I worked with another alcoholic. And they promised me that if I did that, that I would be in God's pocket, nestled in his arms. And that I would be just fine. It turned out they were right. And so, the prospect is not as fearsome as it may sound to the newcomer. We're not talking about going into a cloistered environment. We're not talking about spending 5 hours a day in an ashram. We're talking about practicing these principles, and this means that we're going to devote a certain amount of time each day to our prayer, to our meditation, to our inventory, getting to a meeting, which is where we carry the message. It's where we meet the people who need help, so that we'll be available to help them. And we put in work each day, some work each day for other people. Bill said in his story again, if we fail to enlarge and perfect our spiritual life through work and self-sacrifice for others, we don't survive. That was true then, and it's still true today. Last paragraph on page 16. Most of us feel we need look no further for utopia. We have it with us right here and now. Each day, my friend, simple talk in our kitchen multiplies itself in a widening circle of peace on earth and goodwill to men. You know, I obviously can't prove any of this, it's just my strong conviction that the 12 steps in many respects are the last great hope of the world. I truly believe the 12 steps are for every human being. I believe they're spiritual principles which are universally applicable to every person on this planet. And I believe that the spread of the 12 steps and this spiritual way of life, which is going on at a huge rate, is proof of the fact that not only is this true, but that people recognize the truth of it. One other thing, when you're talking to your sponsees, you need to impress upon them is this. There are all kinds of easier, softer ways bandied about. There's all sorts of psychobabble bandied about. Human solutions would seem to be common, and yet we want them to pick up this book and follow the direction of this book and work the steps in accordance with those directions. And sometimes they're going to want to know why. What is it that's so much better about this? Well, let's look at the record. In 1939, 1940, there were 100. Today, there are millions of those. Millions of from being a program centered in three cities in the United States with small groups, wouldn't even qualify for a normal meeting around here. There are fewer people in those groups than are in this room right now. From that to millions of members in 145 countries, with the big book having been translated into nearly 30 languages, an exponential explosion. We have to ask ourselves, how come? What is it that brought all this about? Now, do you suppose that any of this would have happened if these 12 steps didn't work? Of course not. What more evidence do we need? They work. They work all the time. They work for everybody. And never once have changed since they were first published. Not necessary to change. Because they work. And when you're working with your sponsees, remember the message you're carrying to them is proven millions of times. It's not philosophy, it's not opinion, it's not something written by somebody to get their master's degree. It was not written for profit, it's not being published for profit. It's not something which is a substitute for human solutions. It's a real deal, and it works. Okay, we're on page 17 now. We're going to commence our study of the second chapter. This is an incredible chapter, and it has some things in it which sometimes I wonder if most of the people who inhabit our meetings have ever read this chapter, or if they have, if they've read it recently. Because it simply tells us the way it is. It tells us what's wrong with us. And it does it in no uncertain terms. And then it tells us that there is, in fact, a solution to this terrible problem. But the solution is a spiritual one. It's got nothing to do with human solutions. It has nothing whatsoever to do with QCPI sayings or acronyms or some of the stuff that gets bandied about. It certainly has nothing to do with don't drink and go to meetings. It doesn't have a thing in the world to do with keep it green or you can't remember your last drunk, you haven't had it, some of that stuff. It has to do strictly with one thing. We have to get a loving God between us and the Buddha. Go back to the basics. In our first step, we are going to admit that we are powerless over alcohol. What does powerless over alcohol mean? Why must we admit that? To be powerless over alcohol means only one thing. We can't stop drinking. And yet, the truth is that we have a disease which is incurable, and invariably deadly and progressive, and if we don't stop drinking, we're going to die. Well, what a dilemma this is. On the one hand, you're telling me that I've got this disease if I'm an alcoholic, and if I don't stop drinking, I'm going to die. And on the other hand, you're telling me that in order to recover, I first have to admit my powerlessness, which means I can't stop drinking. What's the solution to that? And that's why this chapter was written, to demonstrate that yes, indeed, there is a solution. When we convene next week,